Now, we've taken some time every Saturday for the last couple months and talked about the external factors that led to Donald Trump being president directly from the private sector, but we haven't talked about the man himself. So I'd like to close out this series and talk about the Donald, because he himself was instrumental to Donald Trump being president of the United States in 2018. First and foremost, Donald Trump represents the American dream. Yeah, he may have come from a little bit higher place than most of us who are watching this video and who are just sitting in the private sector and working along. But what Donald Trump represents is the ability to get a little bit of money, either from your savings or from a small loan, and multiply it exponentially into something bigger and greater than one person could even possibly imagine. Relative to his current fortune, Donald Trump started out with a small $1 million loan from his father, which he has long since paid back. But he's taken that $1 million and grown it into an empire of various businesses and brands and done numerous things to make life better for the American citizens before he ever thought to put his hat in the ring for the presidency. Compared to what he's worth now, the $1 million loan that Trump got from his father would be the equivalent of me investing $100 into a guy who likes to mow lawns and that person going through and making $100,000 or $1 million lawn care business for himself, employing a couple of dozen people. When you look at it in the perspective like that, you look at the fact that a lot of people now want to go through and emulate that success. So of course they're going to go out and they're going to vote for somebody who understands the ability to take a small amount of money and make it into a huge amount of money. And somebody who's going to be friendly to releasing regulations and making it possible for people to go out and do the exact same thing. Now, in all fairness, there are a lot of other internal factors and a lot of other external factors that led to Donald Trump being the most capable person for the office that he now sits in and resides in, but that's going to be the big one. Trump has money, he has power, and he had fame long before he ever decided that he was going to run for the presidency. And that's something that you didn't always see when you were going into these presidential races, unless you were talking about somebody that was coming from a dynastic political family, like the Clintons or the Bushes. And that leads into a little bit of some of the things that we did talk about already. But what we should be taking some time and talking about now. For starters, the cards had to be on the table in a certain way for Trump to be able to make this ascension like he did. And a big part of that is the fact that his predecessor was so prone to moving the country into a position where full-scale socialism could take over, and then again running against people who were advocating for full-scale socialism. Socialism doesn't represent the American dream, not the way we were taught it anyway when we were younger. What it really came down to when you looked at it was the fact that you were given a choice when you came into the primaries and into the general election. You could either vote for somebody who was going to make a lot of big promises to make life better, but in reality, leave the majority of the middle class and the lower class in abject poverty or mediocrity, or even worse, make it worse for all of the middle class people by implementing a full-scale socialism and having 300 million people share the entire GDP equally. Or you could vote for somebody who was able to make a name for himself on his own, who was able to become famous far beyond anything that his father ever did, even though his father was the one that gave him the loan that made all of this possible. And maybe some of these middle class and lower class people could have the opportunity to rise up out of the middle and lower classes, make something of themselves, and take care of the families that are still down in the middle and lower classes and elevate them as well. Now, that wasn't the only reason that people were voting for Trump. Trump was able to talk to people, and he was able to be himself on the campaign trail. That's something that we really haven't seen, at least in my lifetime. Politicians have been performers as long as I can remember. They go out on a campaign trail and they say all the right things, and the ones that are successful are able to say those right things in a way that make all of their constituents feel really good about themselves. But then they go off into the office and they really don't do much. They get everything tangled up in red tape and nothing ever really changes. In essence, when we had all of the career politicians that were running for president against Trump, we knew for a fact that we had the chance to vote for more of the same. With the exception of Carson and Fiorina, everybody else that was running for the presidency had previously held an office, had previously done things like say the right things at the right time, and make people feel good enough to punch the ballots for them, and then get into the office and do whatever it was that they could do to stay in the office for life. I mean, if you're going to be a congressperson, it is kind of nice to sit there and collect $174,000 a year for doing just about nothing and working hard for maybe 3 months out of the year, working mediocrely for 6 months out of the year. But Trump was different than that. He went out and he said a few outrageous things on the campaign trail. There were a lot of us who were at the beginning of his campaign saying that there's no way that he can do any of this, what he's proposing. Some of this is impossible and some of this is just not feasible. I think part of that naivete was a big comforting factor and a reinforcing factor to the fact that we were getting something different out of the Trump presidency. That we didn't know what we were going to get out of a businessman coming out of the private sector and ascending to the top office. But we knew that it wasn't going to be the same thing that we got for the 8 years prior, and to my memory, the 30 years prior to that. But it was more than that. I mean, if a less charismatic person was able to go out and make the same promises and claims and not be able to sell it by either being non-charismatic or being in that smooth, easy, nice way that politicians talk in, I don't think we would have taken Trump seriously. One of the biggest things that we were taught in my generation growing up was that you should always be yourself. You should be yourself and people will like you for you, and the people that don't like you for you are not worth being in your life. And that's how I try to carry myself going through life, and that's how I know a lot of people try to carry themselves through life. They just go out and they be themselves. But sometimes we forget that when we go up to the ballot box. Many of these politicians, as I mentioned before, are just making the promises and they're pretending. They pretend that they're going to be able to do many of these things and then they don't do it. But they say it in such a way that you feel good about yourself when you still vote for them. Trump was different. He was brash and he was himself. There's no doubt that what you saw on the campaign trail was pure, unadulterated New York businessman. You always got the sense when you heard him talking that even though a lot of the people did want to hear some of the things that he said, that he really believed that this is what he wanted to do, that he knew that he had a goal sitting in front of him, and that's what he wanted to do. Now, there were a lot of other factors as to why Trump got elected. I've talked to a lot of people as a political analyst, and a lot of them say different things when they talk about why they voted for Trump, if they voted for Trump, and a lot of them say a lot of other things when they say that they didn't vote for Trump and why they didn't vote for Trump. I mean, you've got your diehard Republicans out there that were going to vote for anybody that the Republican National Committee put at the top of that ticket. I thoroughly believe that Rush Limbaugh would have voted for Chelsea Clinton if the RNC had put her at the top of the ticket. I don't know how you would explain it to his listeners, but I thoroughly believe that if that was who was at the top of the ticket, that's who Rush would have voted for. And there are a lot of voters out there that are like that. It's just R the whole way down without any sort of thought or process to it. But Trump, in his unadulterated capitalist success story, was able to pull a lot of people over from the Democrat side as well. I'm surprised when I watch other commenters on YouTube how many people out there were legitimate two-time Obama voters that voted for Trump this time around. I have another commenter that I talk to here and there. When I talked to him on a Google Hangout, he told me that his original intent when he decided to vote for Trump and not be a Democrat anymore was purely for the entertainment value, something that Trump carries very strongly within him. He's a natural performer. He can be himself but still entertain people and get people to feel good about voting for him, to get people to feel good about buying his products and buying his services. Now, this particular commenter says he's very impressed with the president that he got out of the entertainment vote, but nonetheless, that was his main reason for going through and pulling the lever for Trump. But that's not the only reason that's floating around out there. I know that Trump resounded to a lot of the Rust Belt people with a message that was more protectionist than I really feel comfortable after I've studied more about it. But the fact of the matter is, like I talked about in the video with Obama and his economic policies, the protectionist aspect really resounded to a lot of Rust Belt factory workers, and that is something that I see a lot around where I live in the middle of Wisconsin. One of the biggest concerns in the household that I grew up in was the fact that any Republican politician that ever ascended to the presidency wanted to do one thing and one thing alone. He wanted to ship my dad's job over to Mexico and have it done for pennies on the dollar. Now, I don't necessarily agree with that's true. I did remember Obama's State of the Union address when he worked around saying that the only viable careers for Americans going forward were going to be button pushers like IT professionals, bankers, and secretaries. And that's a skill set that a lot of people in the middle of the country just don't have. And furthermore, it's part of the skill set that drives our national debt the way that it is. Like it or not, you can't make a GDP if everybody in your country is an IT professional. You have nothing to trade out to other countries. So therefore, you're going to go through and buy everything in from other countries and not give anything back out in return. I'm not necessarily for full-on protectionism or only buying made in the USA products. I feel comfortable buying things that were made in Japan, Taiwan, China, or anywhere else in the world, but I'd also like to be taking some time and selling stuff back to them as well. While I don't know right now how the tariffs that Trump put in place are going to play out in the long term, I do understand the message that the fact that he put the tariffs out there and promised them on the campaign trail meant to the American people. It meant that there was going to be more incentive for people to buy American products, and therefore their jobs were going to be protected, and possibly some of them were going to come back from the other countries where they were sitting and not generating any revenue for the United States. And lastly, I want to take some time and talk about the government by the people for the people aspect, because that's important to me. I mentioned in my freshman politicians video that Donald Trump going to the presidency set a message to anybody else who wants to be in the government or anybody else who's sick of his or her particular congressperson that's just sitting in the Congress and not really doing anything. As I mentioned before, Trump made it okay for everybody out there who wants to be in office to be in office. And that's a dangerous part of the Trump equation, and that's the part of the Trump equation that the lifetime politicians are trying to correct desperately with the Russia narrative and with the collusion narrative, the bank fraud narrative, the campaign finance narrative. That's what they're trying to eliminate right now, because if Trump is successful in 2020, then in 2022, I predict that there are going to be a lot of people that are getting on GoFundMe or taking crypto from a crypto wallet and working up huge amounts of campaign donations from people out there who want to see these seats start to flip, maybe stay in the party that they're in, but just not have the same person sitting in there for 30 or 40 years. I'm not entirely on the train of term limits for Congress people anymore. I do want to see a lot of the seats flip, but I want to see them flip in a different way. I know that if you have a congressperson that's about to get termed out, and there are two very corrupt politicians that are vying for his seat, and he was generally an okay guy otherwise, I would rather see the sitting congressperson, the incumbent, stay in the seat rather than put one of two corrupt politicians back in his place just because he was artificially termed out. But that doesn't mean that I don't want to see a competition for that person's seat. I see seats out there that go completely uncontested all the time at all levels of government because other people believe that they have no place in the government because they're not politicians, and I think that's false. And I think Donald Trump changed that narrative. That was actually the reason that I voted for him, because I wanted it to be okay for people to go out and run for government. I want the only thing that keeps a person from running from an office to be financing and funding. Because we're moving into an era of crowdfunding and Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies that are really going to change the table on that, in my opinion. There are enough independent commenters out there that we can get the people out there that the mainstream media don't want you to see and get their messages out there. We have YouTube, we have BitChute, we have Twitter, Minds, and Gab. We can start riling up the base for people that otherwise think that they have no chance because they can't buy a $1 million TV ad. Plus, we can give them Bitcoin until they can buy a $1 million TV ad as well. I know Trump does some stupid things, and I try to call him on it when he does. And I know he's done some things that I didn't necessarily agree with when he did them, but they wound up turning out in one of the best ways that I've seen. But I can tell you this for sure. Trump was definitely better than any of the other alternatives that were offered for the 2016 election cycle, both from the Republicans and the Democrats. And really looking at his presidency and his candidacy, I legitimately believe that in 2016 he was the best person for the job. For all of the aspects out there that were stacked against him, for him, and from him. What did you think about the Donald Trump campaign, and what do you think about the Donald Trump presidency? How do you think the country would be right now if we had Hillary for a president, or Cruz, or Rubio? I always welcome a thoughtful and positive discussion in the comment section below, and especially over on Twitter, that is at @edsblogtwitter with a one in place of the I. Thanks as always for listening to this show and supporting this channel. And remember, never take the words of bloggers, podcasters, or journalists as gospel. Find all the facts and draw your own conclusions. Take care, everyone. You're